Hi, everyone. I'm Chris Field. I'm the director of the Stanford Woods Institute for the Environment. Welcome to the first ever Woods Conversation on Climate Solutions. As all of you know, the Woods Institute is focused on practical solutions to environmental problems for people and the planet. And one of the things that occurred to me in thinking about how we generate practical solutions is that in universities, we're really used to being talked at, but we're not really used to having conversations on key topics. And so what we're doing here is initiating a series of conversations that are really intended to be two-directional, where the program isn't so much about presenting an accomplished world leader, but it's about exchanging ideas in a way that can help us build a shared understanding about an important topic. The essence of the way we're going to proceed this afternoon is Laurence and I will share ideas for a few minutes, but most of the session is really going to be about discussing your topics and your issues in a way that I hope builds a fabric and a foundation of two-way communication. It's a remarkable time. In 3 days, on November 4th, for the first time ever, the world transitions from not having a climate regime in place to having a climate regime in place. And Dr. Laurence Tubiana, who I'll introduce in a minute, is absolutely central to the emergence of a climate regime. I want to start out with a statement from Prakash Javendekar, who's the Indian Prime Minister, made after the close of the Paris Climate Conference last year. Javendekar said, "We've opened a new chapter of hope in the lives of 7 billion people on the planet. We have the planet on loan from future generations. We've today reassured these future generations that we will all live together and give them a better Earth." And it's a remarkable place to be in history that we're really moving in 3 more days into an environment where we literally are tackling the defining challenge of our era. And we're doing it, I would argue, thanks in no small measure to the really heroic contributions of Dr. Laurence Tubiana over the last many years. Laurence is currently the French ambassador for international climate negotiations, and she led the work of the French delegation at COP21. Laurence, a distinguished economist and diplomat, had been involved in climate work over many years in the government of Prime Minister Lionel Jospin. She worked on the Kyoto Protocol. She worked through the Copenhagen negotiations and has really played a role not only in advancing the climate agenda, but understanding what works and what doesn't and laying the foundations for success in Paris. Laurence has a long history of generating important institutions. Shortly after completing her PhD, she started an NGO that was focused on North-South cooperation. And then in 2001, she founded the Institute for Sustainable Development and International Relations, been extremely important in the international scene. And then in 2014, became the French ambassador for international climate negotiations, and really played a central role in creating not only the essential features of the Paris Agreement, but also the culture that allowed it to be successful. As one example, she changed the dress code for Paris so that people were actually comfortable enough to negotiate. She made sure that the Paris conference had amazing food so that people were not cranky and miserable even when it was 2 or 3 in the morning and the negotiations were continuing on. But more importantly, she and her colleagues really figured out a way to build a climate agreement based on bottom-up contributions of parties from around the world that established a framework so that everyone could feel good about participating. And what I'm most impressed at with Laurence's contribution is that she and her colleagues in the French presidency of COP21 created an environment where nobody walked away from the table, where everyone stayed engaged throughout. And I think that singular contribution is what really allowed the world to come together with the Paris Agreement that, amazingly enough, goes into force 3 days from now. So Laurence, thank you very much for joining us today. I'm really looking forward to your thoughts. And as we're now just a few days away from the next COP, the first COP ever focused on implementing a climate deal, I wonder what you can say about your expectations and your hopes for Marrakech.
Thank you, Chris, and I'm very pleased to initiate this conversation here, and thank you for this very kind introduction. It was, of course, an impressive moment on this 12th of December in Paris, and when you see the photos and even the film and the people jumping, dancing, kissing each other was an enormous joy. Everybody just even crying for emotion. It was really something, I think, something you go through life. I was recently with Lord Stern, who is a good friend of mine, the author of the Stern Review, and he told me it was really a moment in my lifetime I would never forget. So this really, it was a big privilege to live through this. Now, of course, Marrakech is a different style. It is, of course, about implementation. But again, this early entry to force is an incredible surprise. As I told to some of you earlier in the afternoon, when we decided to, we were finishing the text, and then there was a line on the end date for ratification. And so we had a date. And we said, maybe we take out the date and see if finally it would come before 2020. Of course, the normal thing would have been it has to be ratified before 2020 to really be applied at 2020. So we decided to take it, not knowing really what finally would bring, but hoping that it will enter into force before 2020. Why at that moment in time, we were concerned about the problem of the level of the contribution, too low, and the trying to get as much as possible how the contribution could be revised even before 2020. So that was just the game. And then we decided to take the date out. And that was incredible to see that this, in less than 1 year, could happen. That so many countries, like you tell me, Chris, 86, probably 87 by now, because South Africa is doing it today, are ratifying. Even Saudi Arabia would ratify, or today or tomorrow. So something really unprecedented, never happened in an international treaty. And again, it's just a big one. Again, for the anecdote, when I met the following Monday, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Laurent Fabius, who was the president of the COP21, he told me, I read again the agreement. Well, it's good. I don't know how we got that. So, of course, I laugh and say, I know how we got that. But really, it was just a big surprise to have this complex agreement. Again, maybe 2 or 3 weeks before, there was countries arguing to have a 4 or 5 page agreement on the principles, only in letting all the details for after. So just having this complete, quite detailed agreement, plus this early entry into force, is this sort of big event. So now how to take Marrakech as really a meaningful point to do that? And my view is that there is no much decision to be taken in Marrakech, a very small number of decisions, by the way. One on all the capacity building mechanism, which many times is sometimes well undervalued because it seems technical. In reality, it's very important. Why? Because we need government, in particular in smaller countries, to be able to develop, release their climate plans. And they, for the moment, contribution are sketchy, very uneven. Sometimes it was really a work of a very small team, not mainstream in the policy of the government. So a lot of work has to be done, and we need capacity building for that. The second decision would be about really having to decide how we manage the loss and damages process. And it's merely having a transitional work program. And the third one would be certainly to, of course, a major one, which is to decide how we conduct the work and when is the end date for finalizing all the rules for the full implementation of Paris Agreement. And to decide how we do that, because even if there are 86 or maybe 90 countries by Marrakech, by the first CMA, will begin on the 15th of November. All countries are not there. So we need a process where everyone, which really was a philosophy of Paris, everyone can be able to participate to the definition of the rules. So that will be mainly these three decisions. So finally, the essence is not so much in the decisions themselves. So in the diplomatic work is in a way finished. So now we have to go in a very different direction where we have to, in a way, develop a common understanding that we have to accelerate action. Meaning we have to really go much faster in the implementation of the contribution. And we have to begin thinking on how this contribution has to be upgraded even before the moment we commit to. And that's the delicate political issue, which I'm not sure we can get that common understanding already in Marrakech, but we have to prepare the ground for that. And so the messaging would be through many, many sort of moments of the 2 weeks. As a high-level champion for climate, which is this new sort of role that had been defined in the decision of Paris, and I will do that until November, we will have several occasions with the Minister of Environment of Morocco, who is my co-champion, to try to put all these messages every day and to show that action is already taking place, but that is not enough. So the message is not enough. Will really be very important to produce. And to try to use this 2018, which will be probably, hopefully, the decision we take collectively for the end date for the rule book of Paris Agreement, that this is a moment where everyone prepare itself to really increase action. And so, again, it's quite difficult to grab. So it's a little like qualitative and not quantitative, but it's how we change the mindset we know we are not there and we will do our best to improve that. And we will do that collectively. So the second layer I would like to see in Marrakech is multiplication of cooperation initiatives to really make sure that the donors, the countries, and the financial institutions support governments to do better, that the business are serious about really what does it take for them to be compatible with Paris, and the same for the regions, for the provinces, and for the cities who commit to reduce their emissions. So that we begin to have this, what I would see as two major issues or initiatives taking place, a strong coalition around supporting developing countries to improve their national contributions and to, in a way, begin to find what are the adequate financial solutions for investing in these countries and leveraging on private finance to do that. And on the other side, really launching this long-term perspective, meaning what does it take to be really serious with the global goal we commit to. And that are the two sort of strong messages I would like to see in Paris.
I would like to go back to those, but I think that people here would also be really interested in a kind of insider's perspective on what happened in Paris. And I wonder if you could share with us a point when you thought things might not be successful and a point when you were sure that they would be successful.
That was several moments.
I'm sure.
I must say. Maybe the first big fear was when we put forward the first text. So we put forward three versions of the agreement text. each time with less brackets. And again, it was like we show that to you, and we discuss, and we come back, we listen, and we come back with closing options. We listen, and we come back with a final. So,
excuse me for interrupting. The bracketed text means that it has not yet been agreed, mm-hmm. proposed but not agreed, and the original versions were almost all brackets, as far as I could tell.
Yes, there was at least 100 and something brackets. So. So the system was, so the first one was, you know, there is, in this bizarre process, nobody trusts nobody. So there is no trust. So that's sort of the first layer. So to just be able to put a text forward is already an adventure, something very risky. We didn't have choice. We have to, because the text itself, which was issued by the process of all the negotiators, was, as Chris said, many, many, many brackets, so you could not negotiate on that. So that was the first very, very difficult moment, and a very interesting discussion within the French delegation, by the way, where we have two options. One was to close all the details, the technical elements, and so that one choice, which and leave the main political option open. And the other choice was we close the main options and then we let people negotiate details. I was for the first one and I won my case. and so that was the first sort of big thing. And I remember entering in the plenary together with Laurent Fabius, the minister, and the text being distributed, and even before reading it, everybody began to applaud. So it was like they accept. So that was a bit sort of moment of we are frightened that they will accept. I think the second more difficult one was in the morning of the Saturday, where I would not name countries. But we...
It's okay to name countries if you want.
Well, there are many. But anyway, we... the most difficult thing was to accept the Article 2, which means to have this global goal, in particular the global goal of emission reduction, meaning the net zero emissions, translated in a way that could be sort of acceptable because zero was not in the text. And of course... The day before, we began to circulate that formulation among the different delegations. And there was no clear response to that. And then at 6 a.m., one big country calls and say, we can't accept that. And that was an awful moment because, in a way, we needed that. We needed to have an ambitious, we need to have some kind of real translation of what beyond, well below 2°C could mean. And I remember going in there, we have then a bilateral discussion with this country, and we managed to offer another option. It was basically a tactical, finally, opposition. But we were frightened to death. And the last, of course, thing was at the latest moment, because we were so exhausted, and probably because there was sort of a change in the text, as you know, unacceptable for US, on the, it was about the Article 4, on the, you know, we wanted to have all countries accept to progressively put forward economy-wide and absolute emission reduction targets, which, of course, was not the case before. One, because before, in the Cancun regime, the developing countries have only sectoral or relative emission targets and not economy-wide. And sometimes it's only partial, very partial measures. And by the way, having this notion of the cap on emission and then the reduction. So that was, of course, the key element. But of course, all developed countries have taken economy-wide and have absolute targets in terms of capping emission and reduce them. But because the US could not accept a formulation that, in a way, put only the obligation on the developed country side and only optional for the developing country side, the text should be the same for the two, meaning that every country should develop economy-wide target, et cetera, et cetera. And then something happened in the final draft. Again, for the anecdotes, and because we know that leakage is a common feature of all this negotiation, we won. The only people drafting were the French team, so there was no group. Second, we distributed the text among several computers, not having the only one computer where all the text was one computer, my computer. And but then when we have to assemble all the elements at the end, there was something happened. We don't know exactly what happened, really. But the term of should was, in a way, introduced to shall for the developed countries. So, of course, that was not possible, and that was discovered at 4 p.m. in the afternoon, or even earlier. And so that was a very dramatic moment. We explained to the leaders of the G77 group that was a mistake, because in previous version of the text, this was not in bracket, and it was just a correct formula. That was just an error for our rich exhaustion, which in a way was true. and then they were just frightened, and then began to have a big conversation, a hurdle in the room, and it was, and other countries like Nicaragua wanted to oppose, etc. And we didn't know what would happen at that stage. And of course, all the negotiators were not happy in some countries with this huge sort of level of acceptance, this level of ambition, to try to reopen everything. And it was really, I remember John Kerry asking me, you would not let us down, because of course for US it was impossible, and it was of course clear from the beginning. And on the other side, and then the Chinese envoy did really make just everything stop, and that we should pursue the adoption. And he was very, very straightforward and very forceful. And again, everything couldn't have happened if there was not a big consensus in every government that no government wanted to be responsible of the failure. If this was not there, and there was many reasons for this willingness not to be the bad guy, which is admirable in a way, because it's easy to be the bad guy. In a way, for some countries, why not? Russia helped. And it was not evident what Russia's interests were in having this agreement. And many other countries helped, even if in their the short-term vision of their own interest, why have an agreement? But finally, the idea that, you know, that the feeling that history is going in that direction, and that you want to be part of history. You don't want to be against. You want to be in the movement. Not only because you don't want to, again, to play the bad guy, but you want to be at one point in time beyond your short-term vision, and you want to be part of history. And that's what happened in Paris, I think.
And just to fill in the story on the should, shall, for those of you who aren't too attuned into the details of treaty approval in the U.S., if the wording stayed shall, it would have meant that the treaty had to be approved by a Senate vote. As long as a treaty said should, which is what the French team had put in there originally, then it could be approved directly by the president. So this one word had controlled the whole success or failure of the agreement. And it was amazing that the world came together to allow revision one to be the final document. Let me ask about the level of ambition in the Paris Treaty. That's the area where I think there are the most questions, where I think you've had the most compelling explanation for how a level of ambition that clearly doesn't get us with the NDCs to the warming well under two is still the right starting point. And how do you explain that?
I have to explain from where we came from and how we stage progressively the process. And I have to explain where the countries were in by January 2015. Again, when we get out from Lima, we knew that for many countries, the agreement should begin in 2020 and be finished by 2030, and that we will renegotiate something new after. So that was a very important element. Because of this decision that was taken in 2014 in Lima, that every country would follow this bottom-up process and putting forward their plans, what we call the national determined contribution, they will come earlier, before Paris. So we have two elements there. One, many countries said it's a short-term agreement, it's like for 10 years, and then we'll see what happened after. So in a way, the plans are for 10 years. And that's it. So we should not be too precise or too complicated about that agreement again. And because, in a way, the decision was taken in Lima to come as early as possible with this contribution, a number of countries put forward between January, end of January, February, I don't remember, and the US and China came in, and Europe, whatever, meaning by April we have already a range of them. By April, it was clear that when you add up the big ones, you were very far from the 2 degrees C, which in a way was already in the air, well below because of the Durban mandate, meaning decisions that have been taken before. So this allows us to begin to say very clearly from the start, and it was a big political discussion, can we stay and state and agree all together that this is not enough? Okay, the contribution are there. We see already that, of course, India was not there. Some countries were delayed. But already with 40% of the emission, we just are off track. So can we at least agree on that? So that was the first discussion. And I remember many meetings with China and others saying, can we agree on that we are off track already, if we want to be anything close to 2 degrees C? They accepted that. And we began to say that very explicitly, we are not there, we are off track, that will not be enough. That allowed us to do two things. Again, it was a stage approach. The second step was, so we can't stop the agreement in 2030. We have to have a longer view because, again, if we have just 2030, the contribution like they are, and we have no mechanism of revision, we are just off track. So that become to say, so the second stage was to make, in particular, the emerging countries accept that the agreement will not stop in 2030. So that was the second stage. We obtained that more or less in May, June. Then for the third level was the revision mechanism every 5 years. Again, too long in a way. But that was the other ones, again, wanted to stick to this 10-year period. So that, by October, we had already the mechanics, the idea that there was no end date for the agreement. The second that there will be a revision mechanism and that everyone agreed we were not on tracks. Then the global goal, the ambition was the last layer we have to put on the side and of course reference in the text that this goal, even if it was very far, we have to revise the contribution and in particular the global assessment we will make all together to know if we are on track for the well to below 2 degrees C or off track. This assessment we do every 5 years oblige us in a way to revise the contributions. And then, of course, we have to have a benchmark against what? And the temperature level is not a benchmark. It's very, just very abstract. It's an average, so it doesn't translate. And we knew that we could not put a number, meaning an average reduction emissions, or we try, of course, all this, but we knew that. And so it was the global goal, the ambition, is very important because that the reference against what we will measure, where we are collectively and where, in a way, implicitly, where every country is, in particular the big emitters. So that was a very, very carefully negotiated sequence. But I must say, we pocketed in the main elements before, and of course that was a danger, was on the last layer, on the ambition goal, on the expression of the carbon budget. Without that, only with a reference of temperature, it would not have implied anything concrete. Again, it can seem very abstract. It's in a text. This text is below 2 degrees C, 1.5, is not legally binding. So you could tell me what the use of it. I can tell you, today, many countries, many governments, many cities, many businesses are asking, what does it, how we translate that, how we translate what may, what means net zero emission by the second half of the century for us. So the benchmark elements, the reference point, the translation between something which is very broad, very sort of aggregate, not broad, aggregate, precise but aggregate, translate into very specifics. And that, of course, the work we have to do now. From now to 2018 or at the latest 2020, every country, every big company, every big city, every big region has to know really what does it take to for every actor to be consistent with the Paris Agreement. And this is will be very concrete.
Great, thank you. I have a lot more questions, but I would like to open it up for questions from the audience.
But that should be shorter in the response.
If you have a question, raise your hand and we'll bring a microphone. And if you could try and keep the questions brief and also let us know your name. Roberto, you can pick who gets the microphone. Dan.
Hi, I'm Dan Arvizu. I'm with the Emerson Collective and also a pre-court scholar here. One of the biggest deficiencies that we see by reading the text is the framework for measurement and verification. Can you speak to what the conversation was like relative to how do we get to that framework where we can actually do these assessments even in the five-year periods that we're talking about in the future?
There is a lot of work still to be done. Of course, the big difficulty is many countries doesn't have the proper tools to measure their emissions, one. And so to be able to report technically. So that's the first thing we have to bridge, the difficulty, the gap between the capacity, the real capacity of measuring and reporting. Again, was even a big country like China, even in 2015, realized that they have a big mismatch between what they thought the emission were and what the reality was. So I think this is a serious matter, the seriousness and the quality of the data. I do think that the system will work if there is the formal system we'll put in place and we define the rules very soon. And the external pressure, meaning the monitoring capacity, in particular of the scientific community. I think we need both. We need independent evaluation. And we have more and more the tools to do that. Whatever the process between government is and peer review and what will be finally the case, I think we need the sort of a voice outside who said, you are in or not, really. And that will be very, very much needed. there are some countries who do not care about their reputation. But reputation is not only international prestige. It's about attractiveness to investment. It's about many, many elements that would, in a way, weaken or improve their economy because we are so much integrated. So that, I think, I don't know still how, but the scientific community at large, the think tanks, and some NGO who have the technical capacity should be able and empowered to give an independent assessment. And I think that's the way this will work. If we don't have this, sort of the evaluation by the third party to, again, to just define, are we on track or off track, I think the system will not work efficiently. So.
Who's my microphone runner? Okay.
Hi, my name is Neil Tongri. I have a question about finance, looking ahead to Marrakech, because there's been a lot of conversation about the massive redistribution of finance from fossil fuel and greenhouse gas intensive industries towards clean energy. But we see the Green Climate Fund is struggling to get out its first tranche of payments. The World Bank is still investing very heavily in fossil fuels. What are the sort of systemic needs that you see, and is this the role of the UNFCCC to redirect that funding that's more than just kind of raising money, but it's addressing whatever other barriers exist?
The strategy for getting Paris in place was not only, of course, to have government agreeing on an agreement, on a text, but in my view, the outcome of Paris, and we try to frame that this way, that has to really having every institutions that, in a way, control or the drivers of climate change, or the drivers of emission in particular, should have be accountable of what this particular institution was doing or not. And so that's why on finance, we try to have at least MDBs and institutional investors and the banking, when the banking sector, we were less successful, at least to announce what their commitments would be. And so we had a first sort of level, the World Bank committing to a certain percent of the portfolio, decarbonized, or climate friendly, the same for others. National development banks did the same. But that's where we are. Now, of course, we have to transform that. And so my view was we have to at least align objectives. Now we are in the implementation phase, and then come back to this institution and say, which I think, I hope there will be a result of Marrakech, a clear ask, a clear demand to this institution, in particular MDBs, and in particular, of course, World Bank among them, to know now what is your strategy to implement Paris Agreement? What you will do, how you will leverage the private funding, how you will de-risk investment in green energy. And I think we have to be precise, and I think this is the only thing UNFCCC can do. UNFCCC cannot decide for finance in general. It can give sort of vision, create the accountability system, but finance ministers are finance ministers. They have to do their job, but we have to ask them. And we have to ask the boards of the World Bank, of the Inter-American Development Bank, or the South and others, the African Development Bank, to, are you doing it? So that's the first thing. Really, now make the institution accountable of this framework, which is accepted by everyone. The second element is really to go deeper in having, for the moment, there is many reasons. Everyone has a good reason not to invest in these climate plans. So we have to have governments putting forward their policy framework that can enable investment and the investment plan they have, and then match that with sort of a response from the financial community at large and the combination between public and private finance. The Green Climate Fund is part of the solution, but more as a catalyst than it will never be at the size. When we put in this Article 2 that we have to shift the finance, it's shifting the trillions. It's not having the 100 billion, which never will not do the job, or having the GCF even at 100 billion. That will not do the job either. So now we have to find a way, of course, to make, everyone looking very candidly at what he's doing. And it's a big revision. How much many of these banks are still financing coal power plants, coal-based power plants. If they would choose to do something else, what is the alternative available? So this has to be very concrete now. But we need to create somehow an accountability discussion and really to ask them, what will you do? And that's why in Marrakech, I would like to see that as a clear demand to this institution and asking them to report by next year to say what they have done. Again, to create this positive loop. But it's just the beginning.
There are a number of questions in the front as well, if we get microphones up close to the front.
Good afternoon. My name is Caroline Nowacki. I'm a PhD candidate in sustainable design and construction and also a lecturer in international policy studies. And I have a question about, I'm interested in Habitat 3 and cities in particular. So we just had a new urban agenda accepted by a lot of countries last week. I'm wondering, almost no one heard about it compared to like the COP21. So I'm wondering if you have opinions about this text and the process of Habitat 3 compared to COP21. So also thinking about what made COP21 so successful compared to other international conferences. And also, how do you think cities and local government can integrate this like a climate agreement into their own strategies?
It shows that climate change has much more visibility. I don't know the details of the Quito text, but I understand this is really aspirational. There is no obligation for anybody. You have to understand that the Paris Agreement is hybrid. It's not only voluntary. There are obligations. And they are very big, by the way, in reality. That's why when people just began to read again, they said, well, what did we accept in Paris? So I think that's the maturity of the discussion. For the moment, what are the common... So that's one. The second element, of course, is the global nature of the issue. Of course, the implementation is domestic for climate, but the externality is, of course, global, as you know. On the management of cities, so the way people live in cities and the management of what is habitat text about, of course, is much less global. And that is the second difficulty. Just look at what happened with health issues. When we could establish that at least one part of the health concern where clearly global could be presented as global externalities, the reaction was very different. I remember when this Global Commission on Health and Macroeconomics took place, it gave the sense that finally there was a global interest in dealing collectively to this issue. And climate change, of course, is even a bigger one. So that's why I understand, of course, Quito is a different nature. You can see that water issues, for example, there are many global meetings on water. For the moment, water is not considered still as a global issue. And then doesn't force for cooperation. And you know, it's because countries were really frightened about climate risk. It's because when the third and the fourth and the fifth report of IPCC just make that you could not escape the reality of the impact on climate change on you, that countries decided to move on. If without that, they would not have done it anyway. So that's why I think this notion of a global externality, and meaning it's a climate stabilization is a global public good, means that this, it's finally a very intellectual thing, but in reality that motivates the global sort of visibility and the implication of the global leadership. And that's my explanation.
Ross.
Ross Schachter, Management Science. My question is relatively naive. I understand the should versus shall language is to work around the U.S. Congress. But what effect does that have on the nature of the final agreement and what the ramifications with respect to other countries and their challenges?
Well, in reality, the important point was not there. The important point was that in this particular part of this article, every country over time would accept that it has to cap the emission and reduce them. So that was the sense of the phrase. That there was a difference between the developed countries and the developing one, the developing Fed having as an obligation to do that, and the other one only as an incentive to do that, was a problem. Why? Because as you remember, there is a particular statement in the resolution in the U.S. Congress, or in the Senate, I don't remember. That's terrible.
Yes.
That just prevent the U.S. government to do something that is not comparable with its competitors, so to do more. So that's, it's not only because of this legally binding nature, but more a comparability between U.S., clearly between U.S. and China. That was the issue. So in reality, the important element, which is still there and hasn't changed, is that everyone has to cap the emission at one point in time, and of course, as soon as possible, as it is written in the text. So in reality, it was only the only difficult point which put, in a way, the agreement at risk, because U.S. could not accept that, as Chris said, but because everyone could want to reopen everything. And then we could not make the deal at that hour, in that particular day. So in the substance, it doesn't have any impact. What I recognize that now, for at least the major economies and the major emitters, the 20-something major emitters, they have accepted the idea that they have to have a cap on emission. It's a terrible, it was really a very, very difficult issue, because for Brazil was already accepting that somehow, but for South Africa, for India in particular, to say at one point in time, we not increase our emission compared to what the needs of our population is, and to the enormous increase of energy demand we have, it was really a very difficult thing to accept. And so the entire issue was around that. And again, I can tell you, we had a long discussion between China and France to have a common declaration on this particular topic, how, in a way, even quote-unquote developing countries, meaning emerging countries, accept to say we will cap our emission and then decrease. That was for China a very complex issue, and for good reasons. How you know what will happen in your, if your economy is growing by 10% a year, which of course is no more the case now, how you can say my emission will cap at that date and decrease when I don't know if I will have available solutions without carbon for energy. So that's the uncertainty of the future is a big concern for all this agreement. How you project yourself in 20, 30 years' time and say, I will have the technology to be free of carbon. That's exactly what it is in the text. But that, of course, is very difficult just to accept beforehand, before you know you have that. So, again.
And are you a technology optimist personally, or do you feel like this question of the uncertainty about the availability of the relevant technologies when we need to make the cuts is going to mean that economic growth suffers?
I think we observed already that a lot of some countries are already decoupling economic growth from emissions. We see that major, it's the case in all Europe. It's the case, of course, in the US, of course, because of the economic structure, but all because of sort of a cleaner energy over time and a much more energy efficiency as well. So I think we have to bet on the two elements. One, probably, and of course, to use the available technologies, and you know that better than myself, even Chris, and this university in particular, than with available technology, we could already do a lot, and in particular, reducing unnecessary consumption of energy because we are wasting it. But we have to be technological optimistic at the same time because we know that we don't know how to do negative emissions, meaning taking carbon out of the atmosphere, out of the air, or even storing it very, very efficiently. Still, we don't know exactly how to have a 80% integration of renewable electricity in the grid. So all this is still to be defined. And I think the big positive message that this agreement is sending is we believe we find a solution. That merely is a message which is going through. And I remember, again, for the anecdote, you know, India, it was very difficult for India, really, because of this. India is sort of emitting 2 tons per capita around that for the moment. And of course, many, many people doesn't in India are really under the poverty line. So to say we will cap this energy consumption seems really impossible for, in particular for a prime minister that put economic development as a first objective. And the way we bring India in the room really was around this innovation technology. And for the anecdote, I arranged, of course, a formal, normal bilateral meetings between President Hollande and Prime Minister Modi in New York in September 2015. And Modi was still totally not convinced exactly where this could land. And because we were preparing with Bill Gates this big announcement in Paris of what we call mission innovation, which was the idea of having doubling the research and development budget in governments and having venture capitalists to come in, we decided to propose to Modi to be one of the leaders of this initiative. And I remember the two heads of state were talking together on classical matters, military, security, etc. And then we make Bill Gates come in, and I saw Modi smiling, really just so happy to see him, because he was like, I think he's a total geek. Modi is a total geek. He likes to talk about where you put your solar panel on the wherever, and of course for President Hollande, which is not exactly that style, it was a little bit of a surprise. But they began to talk to each other, to Bill Gates and Prime Minister Modi, in a very sort of animated way during, I think, 25 minutes, just exchanging ideas on the solutions. It was really fascinating to see that. And for Modi, it was the way. So he could enter the climate discussion with this angle. And I think the beauty of Paris was we need all the angles. We need the economy, we need the finance, we need the technology, we need the uncertainty on the future, but the optimism of technology as well.
I can tell that Laurence is starting to lose her voice. Could you take another question or two?
Yes.
Okay. Maybe somebody has a longer question. No, go ahead.
Hey, I'm Rina, and I'm a law student here, and I actually interned. at the UNFCCC Secretariat in 2015 as well. My question concerns the loss and damage regime in particular, because those terms for a lawyer have a lot of content, and I'm just wondering what's your view on the future of that agenda, because it's still in development as far as I understand, with regard to liability and possibility of compensation, such as with regarding displacement of people. I know there's some text that was inserted on US initiative to kind of exclude liability in this realm, but if you're able to answer on what's the future of loss and damage in the agreement, it would be very interesting to hear. Thank you.
That's an important question. Again, that was part of the last positive movement on the last month, Of course, initially, the idea that even if we open the discussion in many informal meetings before, for the US government and many others, but in particular US government, this was a no-go. Creating any liability because of climate impacts was something they could not accept for many reasons, you know, but in a way the tradition of law here in this country, where liability means liability. You know, you can go to a trial and you can sue and you can ask for compensation. So that was one side. The other side of the issue was for countries, which I think it was an ongoing discussion, the countries will be affected by climate policies, reducing consumption for fossil fuel, for fossil energy, for example. That was, of course, the demand of many oil-exporting countries who wanted to have this compensation recognized in any text, saying we will suffer damages because of the countries consuming less and less oil. And, of course, you imagine the discussion. So Saudi Arabia wanting a compensation because we will consume less oil. Of course, impossible. So this was why the discussion was very complicated. And the initially, I think the US position was, we don't want this in the agreement. We can have a decision, we can have others, but we don't want that in the text. I appreciated a lot the flexibility of the US government at the end, understanding that to have an agreement that is really owned by everyone, you have to recognize that the more vulnerable countries really are suffering and will suffer anyway, whatever we succeed or not. And so I think that was a good move that they began to imagine, and in particular thanks to one particular very bright lawyer of the US delegation, to imagine how you could recognize this loss and damages issue as a cooperation issue and not as a liability issue. So that's what is in the text. But of course, it is, and it will be very important in the future, again, as a benchmark. Because if we fail, I think it's legitimate that this island that would disappear, this vulnerable population that will suffer so much, these climate refugees, in a way has a say, has a sort of a, can make their voice listened to and valued, and in a way we have a responsibility. So we move from a liability to a responsibility, and I think that's fair. And we can't say, as a major emitters causing this problem, we are not responsible. That's not true. That is what is recognized in the agreement, and that's important. Over time, we can see many developments. Maybe the liability element would come in, and I know that some people, think tanks, NGOs are thinking about this, but we'll see, no? And that's why I think this notion of we are responsible, which is really true, is there. But again, that will take time to develop as a sort of a complex process.
I believe it's 3:00 in the morning in Paris, and I know that Laurence has a major presentation to give tomorrow. Is there one more comment you'd like to make in closing?
I think we are, just to make you feel as I feel, but I'm sure we share that, that we are really at a turning point. And again, when you, we should not overestimate what an agreement is about. But I think if we take this as a sign, a powerful sign, but a sign, that there is something different, that there is a change in the mindset of many people, of many government, of many business sort of leaders, of many local governments leaders too, that we can't just follow the same line, that at the same time there is a sort of an incredible excitement about innovation. And again, I don't think only around technology, but about organization, about social compromise and social compacts around the new development model. If you feel that we are in this phase, it's a very exciting phase and a very mobilizing one. And that's, of course, my feeling. Of course, it's not a given. It's a big, big battle against conservatism, past dependencies, inertia, in a way, feeling of impossibility. So that's what I wanted to share. I think if we join forces, if we just begin to really fight for it, convince for it, invent, I think the future is really incredibly exciting, even if it will be, of course, very difficult.
Dr. Laurence Tubiana, thank you once again for a wonderful conversation.